I am Stavroula Sampani and I'm a researcher at the Joint Research Centre of the European Commission, working in the unit of chemical safety and alternative methods, which incorporates the European Union Reference Laboratory for Alternatives to Animal Testing, the URL ECPAM. I studied chemistry and I subsequently pursued a PhD in the University of Sussex in UK, working in the fields of mainly material chemistry and organic catalysis. Organic catalysis is important for industry to synthesize pharmaceuticals with very specific features, such as stereostructure and reactivity, or to synthesize materials, functional materials like polymers. During my PhD, I developed efficient methodologies for catalysis by designing and testing hybrid materials which employ earth-abundant metals like copper and zinc, and I checked if they are suitable to promote organic reactions. Catalysis is important for synthesizing the chemicals of interest in an efficient and economic way, and once you have produced these chemicals, you can then further screen them for their properties and reactivity. So I synthesized many of these organic compounds, such as propargylamines, used as pharmaceuticals to combat Parkinson's disease, for example. And after finishing my PhD, and before joining the Joint Research Centre of the European Commission, as a chemist with background in material sciences, I worked for 2 years in the European Food Safety Authority, EFSA, in Parma, in the food contact materials domain, and mainly in the area of risk assessment of plasticizers intended to be used for food packaging. In my current job, we actually do science for policy. We are developing, evaluating, and harmonizing methods for the regulatory safety assessment of chemicals while protecting animals used for scientific purposes. Such methods include in vitro experiments and computational modeling approaches. And combining these two, I'm actually exploring the biokinetic considerations related to the metabolism of chemicals that contribute in predicting the risks for the consumer. The ultimate purpose is to establish actually scientific credibility of the predictive toxicology in the context of integrated approaches to testing and assessment. The systematic search in databases and the use of softwares for collecting and evaluating the chemical and toxicological data that we have are integrant part of the work. And as you can imagine, many STEM fields are combined, such as chemistry, biology, maths, informatics, and even machine learning. In general, this is a good thing because I believe that having experts from multidisciplinary scientific fields working together is the best way to achieve the optimum results. Well, the biggest source of inspiration for me were two of my science teachers at school, who would not only transmit their knowledge by theoretically explaining basic scientific principles, but also engaging the students by experimentally explaining a phenomenon in chemistry and in physics whenever they could, like, for example, by setting up simplified laboratory setups at school. They would also organize trips to science museum, or they would show us videos and documentaries about various scientific topics. Another source of inspiration for me was my aunt, who is a researcher at the Greek National Center of Scientific Research. And when I was a teenager, I was visiting her often in her laboratory, and I was listening to her explaining me about her experiments related to cytogenetics and leukemia treatment. This was very inspiring for me back at this time. In a daily basis, I keep up to date with scientific and regulatory developments in the fields of new approach methodologies, such as complex in vitro methods or biokinetic aspects. Moreover, I perform data analysis, scientific writing, and of course, I communicate the advancements to the regulators and to the scientific community, and also to the public. I have regular internal meetings with my colleagues, as well as external meetings with stakeholders and collaborators from industry, academia, and other European and international bodies. My career path started with a bachelor's in chemistry at the University of Ioannina in Greece, and subsequently with an Erasmus placement in the materials laboratory of the University of Sussex. This was very enriching experience from a professional point of view as well as from a human side, because the Sussex University was a very vibrant environment conducting world leading research with scientists from all over the world, actually. So because I was very satisfied with this experience, I decided to go back there for a PhD. And although I often, you know, heard stories about students having a difficult time while doing their PhD, myself, I have to say that I quite enjoyed the time in the laboratory back at this time. I enjoyed a big part of a bigger team. I took the opportunity to collaborate with other laboratories and to learn about scientific fields beyond my main area of research, like biochemistry. Another thing that I enjoyed a lot was the communication of my results to the public and to the scientific community, for example, presenting in conferences or publishing in international peer review journals. After my PhD, however, I wanted to pursue a more active role in science with impact, ensuring coherency in scientific methods that protect the consumer and the animals and have direct benefits to people's everyday lives. And this is how I started applying in European institutions. In my job, any background in science, especially chemistry, biotechnology, toxicology, or even data science is suitable. In today's world that everything is available online, I actually find it very important skill to be able to find the right information without getting lost in the huge amount of data that they are out there online. In other words, to find the piece that completes your puzzle, that fits to the purpose of your project. Another important skill is dealing with big sets of data and managing your time properly, because these skills, okay, are in general needed for science-related jobs, but since my job is specifically a researcher's job, where innovation is a key element, you need to know how to deal well with new data or a lot of data that are brought together to build something new. So this results to the aforementioned analytical skills being vital for the role. No one was born to really have them. You just need to constantly work on them. Additionally, I consider adaptability and resilience very important. And these are elements that I believe that also contribute to optimization and innovation in general. And the ability to convey the right message to a non-expert audience is also very much needed, especially in science with policy-making purposes. Another personal key skill that I find necessary is the ability to establish fruitful collaborations that last in time. Bringing together experts with different backgrounds to work on a project and seeing the things from multifaceted sides can bring the desired excellence to the results. Well, with my skills, I could decide between various career pathways, such as industry, pharmaceutical, chemical, or food industry, most probably in the research and development departments or in the product optimization sectors. Another possibility would be to switch back to academia with a postdoc or to become a chemistry teacher in secondary education. And finally, another option which is less explored, less advertised maybe actually, would be to work in consulting companies that provide advice to other companies to develop new products when, for example, they wish to go through market authorization procedure, meaning approval of the product by European institutions and permission to access the EU market. For example, a company that wishes to produce recycled plastic needs a positive scientific opinion from EFSA, considering the product safe for the consumer and thus approved in the market. Well, I think that the main challenges of doing research with policy-making purposes is to keep on constantly being motivated and dedicated, because it is challenging to see your initial test experiments failing or to solve problems that you would not expect to face throughout the project. And specifically when it comes to science for regulatory purposes, I think that the skill of public speaking and also spontaneous without preparation is needed. Well, my advice to students who would like to pursue a STEM career would be to follow their dream with dedication and passion, patience and commitment, and not to hesitate to ask for information from any possible source and, for example, to discuss with university students or early career researchers about their thoughts on what to study next or where to go for a traineeship. In cases also that you feel indecisive, remember that the environment around us is always can always be a source of inspiration. Because, for example, meeting people that have common scientific interests inspire you or believe in you, like supervisors and mentors, or finding out about a fantastic, well-equipped laboratory that gives you inspiration for turning your ideas into practice is always a good sign to start from. In my opinion, a fundamental role for parents and teachers is to encourage students' playful exploration, to give them the appropriate stimuli to love science. A promising approach would be that parents and teachers could use homemade experiments or, in general, experimental simplified setups, or visit science museums, or showing to students documentaries related to science topics. These are some methods that they go beyond the book and the blackboard, and they could inspire and cultivate students' love for science. The three arts careers are very important, not only for the obvious reason, the animal welfare, but also because animals have different, completely, physiology from humans. And this means that they are not representative models for obtaining direct toxicological information related to human physiology. Science has now evolved so much that we can also combine complex in vitro data and computational models and biokinetic aspects, and we can predict with high accuracy what the chemical does to the body and how the body metabolizes the chemical. So in other words, we can predict the risks with higher precision using the three R's.